yes. I want that. Oh, I need that. Got to have that.
But you, a lot of your video content to me was very informative. You know, the things you talked about had substance, man. And I first really knew about you because of JT Riley One, Real Nigga News. And you and him got into a conflict with each other. And when I did my website, you were the only brother. And let me stress that. Because when I did that website, blackcommune.net, and I did the video and I asked the black YouTube community, the so-called black YouTube community, to give me your videos. Because at the time, a lot of brothers were getting flagged and videos taken down. So I said, you know what? You can put your videos on my website so that the message can still be heard for all to hear. You know, something like, you know, a little I made that website for everyone, but you were the only one that gave me permission to use your videos. And I thought that was very honorable of you and really a testament to how much you cared about the black community. Because all these other brothers that talk about it, you know, and say they love the black community and all this other shit, when it came down to supporting me or helping me out, they were nowhere to be found. And that's really a big sign. If somebody really care about black people, then they will want to help black people. But you were the only one.
Free your mind.
I gotta bring this up because I was in the chat room on one of those videos that Sonetta Studios was interviewing Eric Muhammad. And speaking of Eric Muhammad, I'm gonna have to respond to some of those comments he made. And this is the killer thing. Not only Eric Muhammad, but many people, I lost a few subscribers. I guess they were new to my channel and they did not know how I talk as far as black folks are not Aboriginal or African. I broke it down simple and plain. If you want to try to refute, if you want to try to debunk, please send me an email. You can come over here. I'll let you just talk and talk and talk. And then, unfortunately, I'm going to have to give you the old 1-2 and destroy and even laugh at you a little bit, because I'm going to have to, because I'm going to have to show you and make you pay for rejecting the truth. I don't like doing that. I don't like making mockery of people. But we run around here and we just refuse to accept reality. So I'm going to have to just start making mockery of these people, laugh at you. I'm gonna have to just do that because you refuse to accept things for what they are. I don't know what your problem is. You claim that you love the truth and you seek the truth, but when reality, when the truth comes, you don't like it because you become loyal to a damn lie or a half-truth. Some of these things we were taught was not intentional, but they still are in error. Like I explained to us earlier this morning, 1 + 1 = 3. In order to get to the right answer or to the right conclusion, you must take all factors into consideration. This is why a lot of innocent people go to jail, because a lot of evidence was not presented to the jury. The jury can only judge the evidence that's before them. If they are not presented that evidence, then they can send a person that's innocent to death row. And I guess that's what y'all like to do. Because some people don't mind watching somebody get the electric chair. I'm not about that. We're gonna put all the evidence that we can and analyze it and come up with the best conclusion that we can. So I was on Sonetta TV last night on one of those videos. He was interviewing Eric Muhammad. And I brought up the situation. I was bringing up the situation where I asked them, I said, look, what about this Minister Farrakhan kissing this white dude? Y'all want to explain? Hey, what's up there, Arden? Hey, Sunshine. I was just asking them politely. I don't disrespect nobody. I ask civilly and politely. What's up? Yeah, yes, I do. I asked them politely. I said, look, what's up with Farrakhan kissing a man? Because, see, Elijah Muhammad is your example. Where does this come from? Now, me personally, there's something I talked about it early in a video. The FOI do this kind of greeting where they touch each other cheek to cheek and draw your brother in. I'm like, man, quite honestly, I'm going to tell you, the brothers did not like that. You ought to see how uncomfortable most of the FOI was. They did not like that greeting. And I'm pretty sure they still doing that greeting. I'm not touching no man cheek to cheek. I'm not doing that. Next thing you know, it'll be butt cheek to butt cheek. No, I can't do it, y'all. I can't do it. So Minister Farrakhan is kissing this white guy. Farrakhan is kissing this white guy dead in the mouth. Now, I do know when I was in the Nation of Islam, they was talking about how the Italians do it. And that's what I said, Sunshine. Yeah. You know, they talk about how other men do it and it's not gay. I don't care what other men do. It's gay. I don't care what you're talking about. I'm not kissing no man in the mouth. Now, I might kiss my son on the cheek. I still wouldn't kiss my son on the mouth. I wouldn't kiss my daughter on the mouth for that. That's to me, that's funny. I don't like that. Y'all getting too friendly. Then you turn around and talk about homosexuality. Farrakhan kissing a man in the mouth. So what I'm asking, and it was somebody on there trying to justify Farrakhan kissing this guy in the mouth, and they got tired of me messing with this question, so they blocked me. the moderator blocked me, whoever. But see, that's a question you're not going to be able to avoid, because we're going to keep asking that question, because I'm thinking about everything I know about Elijah Muhammad. Now, I'm pretty sure maybe Elijah Muhammad did that little FOI greeting. I never saw him do it, but I'm pretty sure maybe he did that with the brothers. I never saw Elijah Muhammad. I never heard nobody talk about Elijah Muhammad. Yeah, Sir Sean. It reminds me of when Lil Wayne and Birdman kissed. I talked about that too. I'm like, what? Y'all go for anything. These the same people that are turning around and talk about I'm against homosexuality. You running around kissing men, and if you're not kissing men in the mouth, but because it's Farrakhan, he's exempt. Farrakhan said, and that's not gay, you know. Dude, that's what the homosexuals do. He said it was like a father and son thing. I'm not kissing my son like that. Matter of fact, you know, when your children start growing up, they don't even like getting kissed on. Go away, daddy. Go away, mommy. They don't want to be kissed on like that. Children don't even like it. That tells you that you need to leave that alone. You're crossing a line. The child don't feel comfortable. They don't want to be kissed on like that. Well, you know, mama gonna do it. She don't care about that. But daddy, see, we gotta be careful about certain things, and it don't look right. I'm not kissing. It ain't that serious. I don't need to kiss on you like that. So I'm looking. I'm trying to find information. Yeah. Right, Sunshine. Next thing, you know, I'm trying to find information where Elijah Muhammad kissed a brother in the mouth. I never heard of it. Nobody said they ever saw nothing like that. My relatives don't know nothing about that. And above all, did Elijah Muhammad kiss a white dude in the mouth? See, Farrakhan get a pass. Farrakhan is not going to get a pass here, because you're talking about homosexuals. And I'm going to say this before we get out of here. Not only are y'all kissing men in the mouth, but there's something else that y'all do that homosexuals do, because you guys are having oral sex and anal sex. That's called sodomy, people. In case you didn't know, look it up. That's sodomy. There's only one sexual intercourse, and that's between the vagina and the penis. That's it. Oral sex is not sex. It's sodomy. Anal sex is not sex. That's sodomy. That's what got the homosexuals in trouble with God in your Bible. It's sodomy. And y'all doing that too. So you got Nation of Islam people talking all that anti-gay stuff, and you committing sodomy, and your leader is kissing guys in the mouth. You want to get angry at me? You can do all that you want to. I'm not the one kissing dudes in the mouth. I'm not the one trying to justify a dude kissing a man kissing another man, or a woman kissing another woman in the mouth. So I guess the sisters do it too. They greet one of the sisters, Sister Captain, and they can kiss her in the mouth. Y'all done turned into a bunch of freaks. Frank had to turn y'all into a bunch of freaks. The freaks come out at night. The freaks come out at night. Y'all have turned into a bunch of freaks. So, you know, and even Eric Muhammad, I bet he doing some oral and anal sex kind of crap too. See, that's sodomy. It's sodomy, people. But Farrakhan can do anything he want to, and he get a pass. Y'all try to justify everything this man do. This man is kissing a dude in front of hundreds of people, and y'all G for that. Oh, wow. Woo! Oh, no, I can't do it. I can't do it. People have the nerve to call me gay. I don't say nothing gay or nothing like that. and you damn sure never going to see me. Well, first of all, I respect my gay and lesbian brothers and sisters. I don't, you know, I can't get into your lifestyle, but, you know, that's you. I don't bother you like that. I don't go around talking about kill the homosexuals and all this kind of stuff. I don't do that. I don't get with your lifestyle. As long as you don't try to force it on me, as long as you don't try to force it on children and stuff like that, we cool. You never heard of me try to justify a man kissing a man or a woman kissing a woman. I don't get down like that. So I just wanted to come out here real short. When you say sunshine, it goes back to the belief that exchanging bodily fluids is exchanging some type of energy linked to cannibalism. Sister Sunshine say, I don't want no man spit, okay? And when you really think about it, woman spit ain't all that great either. You know, saliva, it ain't all that hot either. But you know, if I'm gonna get some spit in my mouth, it's gonna be a female. So hey, I can't do it, y'all. You know, good luck. You know, Farrakhan and Tang, y'all into some freaky dicky. I'm out of here. I'm out of here. I'll talk to y'all later. Peace. Oh, man. Nation of Islam taking me out of my comfort zone. All you guys want to kiss a man in the mouth, raise your hand. Woo! Boy, religion. They justify everything. Right, Sunshine. I don't like shaking the hands of strangers either. Let alone talk about kissing strange folks in the mouth. Hey, maybe I'm taking this too far. Y'all think I'm taking this too far, messing with, you know, just nitpicking everything Farrakhan do, just nitpicking. No, kissing another man in the mouth, not nitpicking. That's some serious business. Because you got young boys that'll copy that behavior because Minister Farrakhan do that, you know? Somebody said I was an instigator. Right, Sunshine. Everybody ain't clean. You don't know what that dude had in his mouth. That's so nasty and trifling.
Free your mind.
I'm so tired, but since I'm stuck like this, I said, well, the subject is new. Well, it's not new. It's one of those redundant topics. That's all we do. We talk about the same stuff over and over again. Hey there, Brother Michael. We talk about the same stuff over and over again. Do you know why? The reason why we talk about the same stuff over and over again is because we're not accomplishing nothing to talk about. We can't talk about anything else because we're accomplishing nothing. So we talk about the past. We talk about something that's old. We keep talking about Malcolm X, Marcus Garvey, everybody from the past. We don't talk about what's happening new, because the new is not accomplishing nothing. The new is not creating nothing new. The new is stuck in the damn past. Stuck way back in Egypt. Like, damn. Not only do you go back to the civil rights era, not only do you go back to 1930, but y'all go all the way, oh, you even, maybe even further than that. The ancient folks, these people are dead and gone. There, it's over. And you're living in the past. So we keep talking about the same stuff over and over and over again. It gets redundant. Reparations, it's a redundant topic. Malcolm X is a redundant topic. Ancient Egypt is a redundant topic. Black male-female relationship. Men do this, black women do that. Same stuff over and over and over again. Like a broken-ass record. And that's because you are broken people. You're broken, living here with racists. And you're broken because of that damn black power, blackity, black, comedic, Hebrew Israelite, black atheist, all this black power conscious, stupid ass garbage. You broken. You sound like a broken record. Same stuff over and over. That's why I had to go through my subscriptions and just get rid of almost all that stuff. Because it's doing me no good. My mind needs to be fed. I need something new. I'm alive. Life interacts with that which is new. Spring brings in the new. New life. That's how it is when you are alive. Life brings in life. Constantly. Life is renewed. And y'all going back to Egypt. I don't care how glorified it was. I don't care how beautiful it was. It's over. It don't exist. You keep talking about, that's just like talking about your paycheck from last week, that $500. That's spent and gone. You got to think about the new paycheck. Is it bigger? Is it? You respect the old. You respect the old. You honor the old. It's over. That's done. Just like the Bible said, things come up like grass, then it withereth away. This is your time. You trying to act like you lived during Egypt, during the time of Marcus Garvey. Some of us was just being born when Malcolm X was assassinated. But that wasn't your time. You was just coming in this mess. That has nothing to do with you. We're the living dead. Trying to get back into the casket. You're alive. Trying to get into the casket with dead folks. I follow the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. The man is. You can't find a dead man. It's over. What is wrong with y'all? What is wrong? Jesus not here. You can't follow somebody that's not here. Somebody that's dead. Somebody that's missing. Whether they are alive or not, they're not here with you. They're not giving you no kind of instructions. They might as well be dead. I remember my little goddaughter. When I got locked up, and I had basically lost touch with my goddaughter. And I was speaking with her, and I was wondering why, you know, basically, she didn't stay in touch or whatever. And you know what my goddaughter told me? My goddaughter told me, out of sight, out of mind. Don't you know, I don't care how much you love somebody, I don't care how much you praise somebody, when they die, when they are no longer around, out of sight, out of mind. Those people who hold on to that kind of stuff, are considered insane. Because you are alive. You have to interact with that which is before you right now. Else plate. You have to eat what's on your plate. But that's how you do. What is wrong with the so-called Negro in America, the descendants of slaves, having African or Aboriginal ancestry? Another redundant ass conversation. That means nothing. Talking about all this stuff. What is it doing? How is it changing your condition? What is it doing for you? Absolutely nothing. So here we are talking about reparations. I want to make something perfectly clear. I support reparations. There's no doubt about that. Why would I be against reparations? I want to make that perfectly clear. But I know who I'm dealing with. These people, if they wanted to give reparations to the descendants of slaves, if they wanted to give reparations to the newly freed slaves, hey, Amon, they would have done it a long time ago. As soon as the slave was released, was free after the Civil War, they would have gave our people reparations. These bastards have no intent to give our people, us, reparations. Never. Because they do not like you. They don't mind that you sing. They don't mind that you dance. They don't mind play basketball, football. They don't mind that you know your damn place. They don't like you. They don't mind giving you some penis. They don't mind giving you some vagina. But that's all. And they gave you all of that when you was a slave. They have no intent. These people have no compassion. They have no morality. They have no integrity. They have no honesty. You've been living with these people going on 500 years, and you don't know this by now. So we have our people, dark-skinned people, supposed to be our people, the Congressional Black Congress, I guess, Congresswoman Maxine Waters, this sham, this illusion of having a conversation. I heard Bernie Sanders say that he's against reparations, but he would support a Juneteenth holiday. So you Negroes can celebrate and get drunk and stupid like you're doing all the holidays. But I'd be damned, I'm going to give you suckers some money. That's Bernie Sanders. And he's one of the good white people. There's a poll that was taken. And it concluded that the American voter does not support reparations. In other words, I don't like you niggas like that. You think I'm gonna give you Negroes something so you can feel equal to me or better than me? You out your mind. And they always come up with these bullcrap justification. You wouldn't know. You weren't a victim. Well, see, it's not logical, because the victims of 9/11, they got paid. They didn't get blown up in the Twin Towers. They were family members nowhere around. So why did they get paid? They weren't in there. These people are in court every day trying to get money or trying to get somebody put in prison, playing the victim role. But when we play the victim role, there's a problem. They're a bunch of hypocrites. They can be victims, but Lord knows It's a travesty that we play victim, which we don't have to play victim. We are victims. Apparently, y'all don't know what a victim is. If you go out in the forest, deer hunting, and you shoot a mama deer, and she has babies, her babies are victims. They no longer have their mother. You've taken something away from them. You caused these babies harm by killing the mama deer. You harmed our people for hundreds of years. That caused their descendants harm. You stole from our farmers. You beat us with billy clubs, sprayed us with fire hoses. You lynched us all over this country. You caused us harm. These bastards. But that's what we do. We sit around here and you're going to beg these suckers. To hell with that. These people are demons. You're living with some vicious ass wolves. I wouldn't give them the credit to go to them, beg them for no reparations. You lowering your own standards. To hell with them. And then you have our leadership like Louis Farrakhan, the Nation of Islam. This goes back to Elijah Muhammad. They're gonna ask the white man, the white man they call devil. They're gonna ask the devil, you need to give us 10 states or whatever and support us for 20 to 25 years. Are you out your damn mind? Now you know that's not realistic at all. These people are not gonna give you a neighborhood, let alone 10 states. And believe me, under the rule control of the Nation of Islam, I would not live in any of them states. I'd rather take my chance with the white man getting lynched or something, messing with them crazy ass, silly, childish Negroes. I wouldn't go nowhere. These black power, comedic, blackity black folks, they in charge. As silly and stupid and violent as they are to their own people, I wouldn't go nowhere near them. I'd rather take my chance with the white man. That's a damn shame. Fake ass brotherhood. Fake ass sisterhood. So you sit back and you laugh. When I present to us the Mississippi campaign, Operation Exodus Mississippi, oh, they sit back and laugh. Here you are. All of y'all are a bunch of damn beggars on your knees. White man should get, they don't give you nothing. You on your knees begging. Big bad, you talk about God is on your side. Allah is on your side. All these gods is on your side. And y'all a bunch of beggars. Begging the devil, matter of fact. Call the white man the devil. Begging him. But see, you laugh. You laugh at the Mississippi campaign. You laugh at the idea of the Mississippi campaign. But the Mississippi campaign is not begging. The Mississippi campaign is about taking the things that your enemy gave you, take advantage of it, and take your damn reparations. I don't give a damn what the American voter got to say. The only thing, the next thing the American voter know when they look up is you got your state and you're working on the next state. And a damn thing, the American voter or nothing. You're doing everything under the law within the means that they gave you. And if they mess with that, they're going to cause trouble for themselves. Among their own people, because voting and all these things, these tools that you take advantage of, is sacred to all Americans, period. You don't know how to fight it's easier to get on your knees and beg. And then you have a certain group of us talking about, we don't need any reparations. We don't need that. But if these suckers had any type of intent about these checks, these same Negroes, you know and I know, these same Negroes will be the first in line. I'm black. I'm a descendant of a slave. I want my reparations. You know, we're dealing with a bunch of hypocrites. We're dealing with people that's just so damn fake. They so fake. You know this. You take control of a state and get your reparations indirectly. Speak from the power of a state. But see, that's too much for you. You are God. You are God and you are king and you are queen. But you can't take control of a little old state. They just had a bad accident here. Same kind of accident we've been having going on 500 years. And you are separating while you are still inside, putting in yourself in a position where, if necessary, you can have an organized exodus, and over a certain period of years, all of us will be out of America, and these races can have this damn country. And don't worry about, well, my people bled and died. Who gives a damn? Who cares? You don't run it. You don't control it. Since we know we're not big and bad. Hey, what's up? You want. Then you need to use your brain to come up with a strategy to get what you want, whether they like it or not. I could care less what they don't like, what they support. But see, that black conscious, comedic, first black, unapologetically black, pan-African, it don't teach you to think. It just teach you to get emotional over crap. Emotion causes us not to be able to think properly. That's why you should not make any type of major decisions when you're angry, because it just makes you emotional and it causes you not to think and look at things in a realistic manner, because you're just emotional over stuff. That's not gonna get us nowhere. You've been emotional for the last over 100 some years. Where has it gotten you? Not nothing, not a damn thing. That's one of the reasons why I had to get away. That's one of the reasons why I had to get away from the Nation of Islam, because I hear the good, the pretty speeches, the feel good rhetoric. That gets old after a period of time. It gets old by the white man after a certain period of time. You get sick of it. You have to take responsibility into your own hand. You have to take it in your own hand. You stand to a man for reparations and embarrassing yourself, because that's all it is. It's an embarrassment. But see, the problem is you refuse to do what you need to do. And what you need to do is set your happy ass down. You don't have to like me. I don't have to like you. If you really want to have a meeting of all the main players, and y'all get y'all act together and decide how you're going to move in unity. Because without unity, y'all don't have a damn thing coming. Nothing. No reparations, no nation. nothing. You're not going to get a damn thing, period. You have to come up with something that the whole 40 to 70 million in this country can say, hey, I can get with that. But what you have to offer right now, the 40 to 70 million not even paying you no attention, none, none at all. You don't know how to think. The only thing you know how to do is get emotional. The only thing you know how to do is become a reactionary person. When something happens, you react instead of prepare. Prepare yourself. You have all this wisdom, the supreme wisdom, knowledge, understanding, information, and y'all keep doing stuff that goes all the way back to Egypt, the 1930s, the civil rights era. You don't come up with nothing from your brain that is new. Keep repeating what somebody dead said. Jesus dead, Elijah Muhammad dead, Malcolm X dead, Harriet Tubman dead, Sojourner Truth dead, America Evers dead, 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 dead. Hell, are y'all even alive? Are you alive? I don't even know if you're alive. Begging some demons, you know they don't give you nothing. I wouldn't waste my time. It's so embarrassing. Y'all embarrass me. Because you'll never see me begging. Be smart enough to take. I'm going to tell you. See, I would tell y'all my business, but y'all go tell the white man. But I had a sucker thought he got over on me. I made some moves. I could have went to court. I could have did some things. I could have begged him. You know better. You know you should do this. You should do right by me. I know I was dealing with a demon. I know I was dealing with a low-down bastard. Believe me, I used my brain, and I still got what was coming to me. Simple as that. You live in this country. They give you many rights, many privileges. And you don't take care of none. You don't take advantage of none of this stuff. And what would make it more powerful is your unity, which you're not interested. This is the reason why in recent times you see me now making videos against all this black conscious, Nation of Islam, Moors, all this garbage, because they are not interested in unity. So what good are they? They're no good to you. They poison. What is your purpose? If your purpose is not to unify the people, what is your damn purpose? If you're not a friend, then you, damn it, you're an enemy. The only thing they want to do is exploit you and try to get slaves for their plantation. And live happily forever after with the white man. This is what you see. This is a fact, as King Noble would say. This is a fact. This is what you see. Verse. So they can live happily forever after, right here, buying the white man's cars. I just heard, what's his name? Sarnetta. Sarnetta was just talking about, you know, don't be tripping off people because you're getting yours. What are you getting, Sarah? You know, these cars, houses, none of this you produce. Everything that you're tripping off of come from out the factory, produced by your what you call your enemy. And you're supposed to be just living your life and be happy and get all the material things that this cracker can produce, and you can be happy. This coming from Sarnetta. And you wonder why you're going to die a slave? Because all our people have been dying as slaves. Elijah Muhammad died a slave. Marcus Garvey died a slave. Medgar Evers died a slave. Dr. King. All our people died oppressed. We are the generation that can change things. But you don't want to because you happy with your car and your degree on the wall and all the wonderful things Massa give us, ain't you? Yeah, you happy. I know you're so happy. You're happy with all the things Massa give us. I know. Don't you know, if we was willing to do the right thing, man, I'd quit this job in a heartbeat. Get to work on this crap, on this Pecklewood. No problem. We waiting on the mothership, mother plane. We waiting on Jesus. We waiting on the aliens from planet Nuberon. We waiting for Wakanda and the Black Panther. And all this stuff, y'all. Well, y'all keep doing that, okay? You keep doing that. Enjoy yourself. Donate to my GoFundMe. Yeah, that's all we know how to do is beg for money. Bunch of professional ass beggars. Donate to you for what? So you can buy the white man's car, white man's houses, you know, the white man's pizza, whatever. That what makes you happy. Oh, well, see, I'm surrounded by a bunch of happy slaves. Well, believe me, I'm not happy. If I had it for violent, I don't give a damn. Whichever one I gotta do, that's how I'm gonna roll. I am not happy living with these races. I'm not comfortable living with races. I'm not comfortable with them and their fake ass so-called friendship. The good white people. The good white people are some of the worst white folks that you can run into. I really would rather deal with the races. I'd rather deal with the KKK, the skinheads, and all them kind of people. Because at least they're going to be up and up. All these other Caucasian folks. And remember now, remember the American voter. They're talking about the white folks. They don't support reparations. These are the good white people. These are the good ones. They don't want to give you no damn reparation. What does that tell you? These are the good ones. Good luck. What's his name? Tone Talks. Good luck, Yvette Carnell. Good luck, Tariq Nasheed. All y'all begging ass niggas. Good luck, Farrakhan. Getting your 10 states, and they're gonna take care of you for the next 20 to 25 years. Well, they taking care of Israel. They gave reparations to the Japanese. Do you look Japanese? Are you a Jew? They don't give a damn about you, Negro. Talk about what they did for other people. Just like you. It's certain people you would do for, and it's certain people you won't do for because you don't like them. You might donate to Tariq Nasheed. You won't give me a dime. So why the Pecklewood can't do that? Oh, man. Separation. You know something? Now check it out. You might not believe this, but if they saw us actually doing what I suggest that we do, you might get your reparations. You might get it. But see, right now, because you'll be putting yourself in a position of power, of influence. But right now, you're just a bunch of beggars. That's all. You have no power. You have no influence. Everything you got come from them. They know you ain't going no damn where. You might be. You might be busy. You belong to me. You my damn slave. You ain't going no damn where. I can kick you in your ass. I can call you nigga all day. I can do whatever I want. Y'all ain't going nowhere. And that's how they been doing us going on 500 years. And that's why they don't have no respect for us. Why should I buy the cow and I can get the milk for free? Everything he get from us, he get for free. He don't have to buy us. You understand? On that note, let me get out of here.
Free your mind.
Hey, Uma! Not to be popular. It just, I'm inspired by my brother. That reality Temple's brother, the most powerful voice on the internet, that real Angel Snubbing Up 7. That's right, brother. I'm calling you out, brother. I'm building you. I'm putting you out there, brother. I'm shouting you out. That's my inspiration.
Free your mind.
I do want to say something right now. There is a YouTuber who has really got in my heart, and that is Angel Snubbing Up 7. He reminds me a lot of my father. My father died last year of a heart attack, and Angel Snubbing Up 7. Straightened me out. There have been times I had made a couple of videos really attacking Jesse Jackson and Al Sharpton because I didn't like that we only seem to see them when a nationwide case occurs or when celebrities are in trouble. And I didn't like that. But Angel Snubbing Up 7 made a video recently speaking about how we need to band with black leaders. I don't care if they're not doing everything perfect. I don't care that we don't like certain things they do. They're the only support we have. Nobody else is stepping up and willing to be on the front lines like they are. And Angel Snubbing Up 7 was correct. And I want to thank him for that, because he may not have been directed towards me, but he may have been. But I heard what he said, and I want to thank you for that, teacher. I appreciate that. We have to band with people. Even though I do critique and I do make comments about what's going on with the black gender war, I don't hate black men. Like I just mentioned, Angel Snubbing Up 7 has gotten my heart. He's like my teacher, a mentor to me. I love him. And there are others that I love as well that I do listen to, and I do. Last Man Standing is another one. You know, he don't comment much, but I know he's watching. And there are others that I admire them, and those are ones you can work with. Those are ones that you can, we can unify with.
And my name is Myron. They call me Snippy. My name, Myron Johnson. They call me Snippy. My cousin is Dr. Umar Johnson. I'm here to give y'all a message. Y'all better leave my cousin alone. That's what y'all better do. My cousin Umar doing good work for y'all. Y'all some stupid ass niggas, man. And y'all ain't giving the man no money. Y'all think because y'all gave my cousin a little money, y'all think y'all own him. Y'all don't own a motherfucker that up in here. And y'all gonna be looking real stupid August the 2020 when my cousin open up that school. Yeah, he gonna be opening up that school, and them boys gonna be getting educated. He gonna be doing more than y'all dumb ass kids. That was y'all.
Greetings. I'm Tangelika Cox. I have the pleasure of speaking with Talik Ibn Ra, and you know, he has a movement / ministry by the name of the Reality Temple on Earth. And I had the pleasure of speaking with him for several hours today, and I think it's only fair that I do a reaction video to the conversation. And the conversation was on various topics, which was basically centered around African quote-unquote consciousness. And he was a real, real deep brother, very down to earth, very approachable. He didn't carry himself like a know-it-all. Someone you could talk to and really listen to you. It was such an honor to finally meet somebody over the internet that has a ear to listen, and not only an ear to listen, but will take full action on what they stand for. And I appreciate it having that conversation with you, and I do look forward to working with you.
I'm Andre Devin, 69, student and minister of action for the Reality Temple on Earth. And I'm making this particular video about the Reality Temple and how it changed my views and some of my concepts about life. But first I want to say that I want to thank Angel Snuplift 7 for being there for me, administering to me over YouTube and in person, over the phone. The brother believed in me to make these videos. He gave me the opportunity. He gave me the free will to make these videos that I make.